QI that's all about hypnosis, hallucinations and hysteria. And with me tonight are the hypnotic Ronnie and Kona. The hysterical Robert Webb. The histrionic Phil Jupiters. And His Majesty Alan Davis. With such a theme, we're all buzzing with excitement, of course, and Ronnie goes...
You're feeling sleepy.
And Robert goes...
Very sleepy.
And Phil goes...
Your eyelids are heavy.
And Alan goes... So, if I hypnotised you but then cut off your leg, how much fuss would you make?
Doesn't it depend what you've gone in for the hypnosis for? I mean, if you'd gone in to stop smoking, I'd be a bit miffed, really.
That's a very good point. Assuming you'd gone in because you had, you know, gangrene or you needed to lose your leg, but you...
They've never used hypnosis as an anaesthetic, have they? Well, surely that would be screaming in agony.
Oddly enough, no. It was used before ether in the 1830s, very commonly. Well, reasonably commonly, at least. Once Mesmer had sort of, as it were, introduced the world to the idea of hypnotism. What is, seems to be the case is that most of the discomfort we feel, even in an operation like sawing off a leg, is the anxiety of pain. If you can relieve yourself of the anxiety, enormous amount of the pain goes. And a good example to prove this is people who are in some way allergic to or resistant to anaesthetic and so can't be put under because it's too risky. And so they're injected with Valium, which is an anti-anxiety drug. And all it does is tranquilise them, doesn't send them to sleep, it just makes them feel less anxious. And you can do extraordinary things to someone in that condition.
I think if I was going in for surgery, I'd feel quite anxious when I saw the man in the top hat with the crazy eyebrows.
It would be a worry, I agree. But it has a long history. As I say, in the 1830s, there was a Scottish doctor who did a lot of operations in India, where there's a really unpleasant disease called filariasis, and it causes hydrosalese of the scrotum. Now, anything scrotal, you might say, is a worry, but this...
Makes your scrotum go into a triangle.
No, that would be isosceles. This is hydrosceles.
And he never ate dairily again.
These are large tumours, and the operation was so uncomfortable, people would go for years not daring to go to a doctor. But this meant the tumours grew very big. And when I say very big, oh, I mean 46 kilograms. Scrotum. People, literally, there was a case of a man who was using his scrotum as a writing desk. Sorry, but that is true.
Well,
writing.
That's a good attitude.
It's a good attitude. You're right.
Yeah, I would get a Sharpie and I would paint the face off the front of a space hopper on mine.
I'd make it look like a hedgehog. Winking.
This was the 1830s, of course, when there was no general anaesthetic. It was before ether or chloroform. So this Scottish doctor, whose name was Esdale, he would put them under, and it worked. He saved a lot of discomfort.
Your eyes are feeling heavy.
No, as heavy as my testicles, doctor.
You're kind of sort of suggesting that sort of a lot of pain is just a manifestation of anxiety, really,
yes.
Isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the fact is pain is created by the brain. I mean, it's not a real thing.
It's just information, isn't it?
It's information.
But you know, and if sort of hammer
the brain can create it, the brain can be told not to.
It's bloody sore information, though.
It doesn't help you know, land a big mallet on your thumb. It's just information. It's just information. It doesn't really help. I tried to be hypnotised to stop smoking once, and he was such a nice man, and it so wasn't going anywhere, I faked it. I know you mustn't. Even when it's a nice man, just to, you know, save the embarrassment, you mustn't fake it, but I did.
Did it work? Do you smoke? Have you given
up? No, it didn't. I did give up, but with prescription drugs, not with...
Superb. Well, there we are, yes. Hypnotic anaesthesia can be surprisingly effective, though it seems to work mostly by helping you relax. You need answer only one of the following. What's the best way to hypnotise either A, an alligator, B, a tiger shark, or C, a chicken?
I've seen them do it to sharks.
And what do?
Don't they lie them on their backs or something?
Exactly right. You flip it over.
But I thought that if sharks have to keep moving in order to survive...
Which is why whales have learnt to tip them over in order to make them suffocate and that actually will kill them. There's a very small hammerhead shark being...
That is a toy shark.
It's a toy shark.
Or a really big diver. Or
a frighteningly big diver.
I think we'd have heard of him.
I think we would, to be honest.
Leeds are hay.
I think I know how you do chickens.
Yes.
It's weird because it actually looks like you're oppressing them quite violently, but you have to hold them to the ground and draw a line.
Yes. You draw a line from their beak.
Yeah.
Along, and they just stare at it. That's what they do. It's called tonic immobility in animals, and that is the example of chickens. There's another way of doing it with chickens. Apparently, you take a stick or a paddle, in this case it's a light flagellation paddle I happen to have in the house, and you fix eyes to it and you hold it up to it and it will apparently stare at it forever, though our producer tried it on his. We have the kind of show whose producers have chickens. You know, that's how cool we are. He says it didn't work at all. They just went off to eat things. But
you just made that up, didn't you?
No. It is in all the books, it says. That is a way to hypnotise them.
In all of the books?
Well,
all of the chicken hypnotising books?
Yes.
How many are there?
Which is why you can't ever let your chickens watch The Muppets.
Frogs, lizards, crocodiles, sharks, all go into a trance if they're turned over onto their backs and held there for just a few seconds. Rabbits and guinea pigs will do the same thing if you stroke them or roll them over a few times first. Do you know how you wake them up, rabbits and guinea pigs, if they're in that state? How you...
You let a dog in.
No, that might be doing. The kinder way is to blow on... The kinder way is to blow on their nose.
Blow on their nose?
Yeah. A little blow on the nose will do it. I have... What have I hypnotised, do you know?
Hugh Laurie.
No. I did it on a television programme. When I was in Maine doing this documentary about America... What's the most famous animal going
Maine.
Out? Maine.
Maybe a lobster,
A lobster. We have a lobster in here. There we are. There it is. Now, how did I do this? I stroked it, I remember. There you are. You stroke him here, that's it. He goes completely still. And I remember the one I did in Maine, it was, I could actually stand him up on his own. You can see it. Oh, there it is, look, there, yeah. They seem smaller there. But there he is, he's completely still. He's not moving a muscle.
Do you do that?
A muscle. There he is, completely still. And if I lift him up, his tail will come up usually, and he'll wake up. have I killed you? Oh, there he is. He's all right. He's still asleep. Anyway, there we are. Oh, he's quite active now under there. So, dinner's sorted.
He's going back to the zoo.
Of course,
Uncle Stephen.
We're going to throw him back into the sea, naturally.
You truly are a Renaissance man.
I wear tights, put it that way. What about, though, I mean, that's humans hypnotising animals. Can animals hypnotise humans? There was a dog, Oscar the hypno dog, who was, who had... There he is, look. Those are pretty amazing eyes, you must admit.
I'm feeling it now. I'll go and get the biscuits.
And the thing is, he could keep up that stare into a human's eyes for a very long time. And he's...
Depending on what human wants to be stared at for that. Like.
Does he charge hourly?
Pack it in, Oscar. Stop looking at me.
Stop it.
So, Hugh Lennon was his trainer. He did go missing in Edinburgh and a reward was posted for his return, although members of the public were warned not to look into his eyes. Does that sound like a publicity stunt to try and get tickets at Edinburgh?
No dog is loose. Don't look at him! Don't look at him! I've seen him. He's in the park.
Presumably, when he's running around Edinburgh, someone thought they'd find him and they go, it's Oscar the Hypno Dog. I'm not the dog you're looking for. I'm a Pomeranian.
So, yes, dogs can apparently hypnotise humans. Snakes, maybe not humans, but rabbits. They're said to be able to sort of freeze a rabbit by staring at them.
They're very gullible rabbits, aren't they?
Aren't they?
Oh, please.
Believe anything you tell them.
Grumpy rabbits.
Grumpy?
Yes.
They can be aggressive.
They're not supposed to be very good pets. They're very grumpy.
I like those big Dutch ones that you can ride.
Sure. They're huge. They're massive.
OK, maybe not ride.
Yeah, right. Crush.
That is a rabbit costume.
A Dutch man wearing a rabbit costume.
That's what you got.
OK, I am wearing a shovel and it's time to go.
I love rabbits.
Oh, my.
Wow, I am thinking maybe I should have had a smaller celebrity.
So, yes, many animals can be put into a trance, but it's probably best to practice on the ones that are lower down the food chain first. So, you're at death's door. Why is your whole life flashing before your eyes?
Is it?
Very sleepy.
Is it the influence of the early 80s film Flash Gordon, where Dr. Zarkov, played by Topol, has his... they try to empty his brain. It's a myth that it ever happened before Flash Gordon.
Yeah.
Since we saw Topol, since we saw it happen to him, that's what we all think will happen. That's my theory.
It's... I love it.
Very, very hard to disprove.
It's hard to disprove, yeah. Except in quoting a letter from Admiral Beaufort, who gave us the Beaufort scale.
Is he Beaufort?
Beaufort. Rear Admiral Sir Francis Beaufort. Yeah, he had a narrow escape from drowning in Portsmouth Harbour in 1795. He saw everything. Each circumstance minutely associated with home with the first reflections. They took a wider range, our last cruise, a former voyage and shipwreck, my school and boyish pursuits and adventures. Thus, travelling backwards, every past incident of my life seemed to glance across my recollection in retrograde succession, in minutest detail. And there are many examples of people talking about it. So why would we think this happens?
Is it just some sort of panic response? It's just like the brain just downloads everything.
Yes,
like a final disc clean.
It's doing your best bits.
Doing your best bits. Well,
just prior to
it. It's the montage.
Maybe it's your brain trying to find a piece of your life that can help you in your present situation.
Ooh. Very good, Ronnie. That is the current and most convincing theory, that essentially if you're in a crisis situation, your brain, which registers almost everything that happens to you in your life, not always consciously, it goes in, and something weird happens, and it plays back all the incidents of your life to find a match, as it were. This happened and then this. There was a recent case of a man who was attacked by a great white shark and he was just about to die and he remembered a DVD his son had been watching years before in which someone said, you know, if the shark comes, plunge your hands into the gills. And he did that and he saved
himself.
It's
quite risky though, isn't it? If you're on the brink of death and you're rerunning and you're like, no, not my dad's 70th birthday. No, not that time. Probably nowadays.
Not that time.
The point is, I think, if you're a doctor or a fireman or something like that with a certain level of expertise, you're in a bad situation. All kinds of similar scenarios play out, and with what seems to be uncanny instinct, you say, we need to do this. Sometimes even before the event has happened, before a building has fallen, because you've been in buildings where things have fallen, and you've unconsciously registered a creak here, a bending of the wall there,
and you say,
get out from here. But the point is, when you're dying and you're drowning, there is nothing. And so your brain just, as you say, dumps everything. It tries every scenario that seems mismatched, and people genuinely
It'd be quite handy if you get the end of your life flashing before your eyes, and then there's a Scottish woman who says, and now that life is available to watch on BBC iPlayer.
Yes! Or if you lose your keys, just put your face down in the basin and start drowning yourself until you get to the point where you last had them. Would that work?
That's
good.
Yeah. Right.
I think that would work.
That's
yeah.
can be terrible if you're drowning and then you... It's Topol's life.
Yeah. Yes, that would be someone else's life.
Oh, no. Fiddler.
I want him Fiddler. Oh, Brian Blessed on the birds, what he called the tree people. Oh, God, I'm Fiddler up Everest, you know.
Do you think with rising crime that death's door has become more security conscious? Do you think they've got an entry phone or a couple of shaved bouncers?
Well, we used to be able to leave death doors open, but now we have kids coming in, nicking bodies, trinkets.
You see people sitting forlornly on Death Avenue, saying, I put the wrong number in three times, I've got to wait an hour before it accepts my next input. It's
so somewhere you wouldn't mind being turned away from there?
Possibly not. And in many languages, there is a phrase for your life flashing before your eyes, which shows the prevalence of this idea. It's there. Persian, Portuguese, Italian, Russian, German, Norwegian, Romanian, Spanish, Swedish, Arabian, Dutch and French all have phrases. So there we are. It seems to be a common phenomenon and may be explicable. It seems that people's lives really do flash in front of their eyes in a crisis, though it doesn't normally do much good, let's be honest. Maybe it's hypnotherapy you need. So why not consult Zoe D. Katz, PhD, CHD, DAPA? I mean, that's a pretty good series of, I would say...
Hell of an anagram. Is she invisible? Because there's nobody there.
My leads are hazy.
Is she an animal hypnotherapist?
She is an animal hypnotherapist. She's a cat.
Aye?
Zoe D. Katzer is a cat with a PhD, a CHT, and that diploma.
Zoe!
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I think Oscar's sitting opposite her.
Yeah. It's a man called Steve Eichel, who is an academic, who wanted to demonstrate the ease with which you can get a doctorate online or any of these apparently important professional hypnotherapy association qualifications, all of which were given to a cat.
Oh, great.
The point is, once you get one, you can then use the others to parlay until you get a whole list of them. And she has got a doctorate in counselling psychology from a mail-order university. The CHT is Certified Hypnotherapist, the National Guild of Hypnotists, no less, and the DAPA, D-A-P-A, is a diplomat of the American Psychotherapy Association, both qualifications which are supposed to connote genuine professional standing. So there you are. So do be on the lookout, gentlemen, when you and ladies, when you go... to see them, if you can get a cat.
It's terrible. My cat's only got a BA.
It is astonishing, isn't it? There are also what are called diploma mills and degree mills, which give out either a fake diploma from a real university or, as it were, a real one from a fake college that doesn't exist. Like they make up one, they say Christ's College, Oxford or something. You see?
Are those hats falling from the sky or are they? Are there hands beneath them?
Yes, there are.
Is that how you get your hat? They're dropped out of a plane and you have to catch
them? Throw it in the air with your excitement at having got a degree.
I like to think that underneath that photo there's about 60 cats. The thing is that if you were a cat and you went... because of the tassels, you wouldn't leave them alone, would you?
You so wouldn't. I got diplomas for all of you, Alan. You've got one.
You can
put that on the wall. That's worth
Abso.
Ronnie. Abso.
Oh, where am I?
It's a QI award.
Be of advanced banter.
But it actually has, yeah, Robert.
Do you get letters from the American Biographers Association or something? And they say, you have been selected as one of the men of the year.
That's a scam.
American Biographers Association. You for expertise in your field.
All you have to do is pay $700.
And it says, yeah, if you would send $695, we'll send you a plaque. Mm. I've got 12.
Well, there you are. Yes. Pseudo-credentialing. It's a big issue. Other qualifications which the same Eichel who gave Zoe the cat managed to get her these qualifications, he found energy therapist qualifications easily got, past life regression therapist and alien abduction therapist. It's just sad.
I'm going to get a guinea pig and make it an alien abduction therapist.
Show me where they probed you.
Are you qualified for that? Yes, I am.
Yes, Zoe the cat is a cat, but that doesn't make her a bad person. I need your help. How can we persuade the audience to elect me Pope without them noticing that we've done it. God. That's wrong. My hand is not that liver spotted.
No, I'm having that.
No, I wouldn't either. No, that's so odd. Is there a technique? Well, suppose I wanted to sell them something without telling them that
some it was... sort of mass suggestion.
Subliminal advertising.
Ah. Subliminal advertising.
Do you mean that?
Appallingly cruel of me to try and pull it out of you and then punish you for it. No, it is. The fact is, subliminal advertising has never been shown to work. It's a complete myth. Although it's banned by most broadcasting authorities or FCC in America and things like that, it's not actually ever been shown to work. And in fact, the person who invented it in 1957, a man called Vickery, in 1962, he admitted he'd falsified the evidence. He claimed he'd used it and sold lots of cola and burgers by putting in a flash frame, a single frame, out of 24 frames a second. Obviously, the eye doesn't consciously register it. But it just hasn't been shown to work. I remember they did one in the Young Ones, an edition.
They used to do it all the time in the Young Ones.
Yeah, they did, didn't they? Yeah.
I'm going back to my childhood, and yes, I'm remembering it all now.
Your childhood?
Well, yes, Ronnie, deal with it.
Anyway, sound. What about audio subliminal messages? Do we know any stories of any famous...
Oh, the court cases about backward masking, they call it.
Yes.
Which is, you know, satanic messages.
Which was Judas
Priest. Judas Priest is the story that's perhaps the most alarming. It was two boys who committed suicide, attempted suicide.
Yes.
And their parents took Judas Priest to court.
They did, indeed.
Do you know what the message was, supposedly, in the track?
It was...
It said, do it now. Do it now, yeah.
Yeah. And so Halford, as part of the court case, Halford went in with a load of records and played them backwards and then just read out a list of things that you could hear in records when played backwards, just to show how...
He also said, I don't wish to paint myself as greedy, but if we were going to put a message in, it would be buy more of our records. He also said, do it doesn't mean kill yourself.
Stephen, the song was called Suicide Solution.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Oh.
Finally, being in a pop quiz pays off.
Oh, of course, yes.
But they say that you can put things under your pillow. Students have lectures on tapes and they put them under the pillow while you're asleep.
Yes. Hypnopedia, it's called, which I know sounds sounds like interfering with the child while they sleep, but it's not.
Yeah, we brought in, we found one of them hypnophiles.
Hypnopedia is in Wikipedia, encyclopedia, learning, and hypno-sleep. And there are pillows you can buy now that actually have speakers built into them, but frankly, there's no real evidence that it works in terms of what's being taught. But if you sell someone classical music and say, contains subliminal music that will increase your self-confidence, it is shown that that will work, even if it's just the music.
Back to the self-hypnosis thing. What about that thing where if you bang your head on the pillow the number of times...
Do you know, weirdly, I found that worked. At prep school, I used to do that, because to get up early to raid the kitchens and things like that and do stuff.
I didn't ever do that, Stephen.
If you want to wake up at four, you bang your head four times on the pillow before you go to sleep.
Or you have a child.
I know it sounds mad, but... Or you have a child, obviously. Yeah.
No, it's just the power of suggestion. This is the thing, isn't it? But auto-hypnosis, it's if you keep telling yourself something's going to happen.
Yes. A self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah. It's kind of like auto-hypnosis, isn't it?
It kind of is, yeah. Yeah. So, other subliminal images have been seen. Lenin, for example, was seen by some in the Labour Party Rose. I don't know if you can... There. There's a sort of...
That's someone from Planet of the Apes.
It is more like that, isn't it? But there we are. So, yes, subliminal advertising doesn't, Stephen Fry for Pope, work. seriously, they'll be great, please. Anyway, what kind of behaviour would you expect from a superstitious pigeon?
They always wear their feathers in exactly the same colour and exactly the same order every day.
Well, it is just that sort of superstition that pigeons have been found to exhibit. It's quite interesting. A very well-known American psychiatrist from Harvard called B.F. Skinner, he found that if you feed pigeons at predetermined intervals, the pigeons, because they can't quite predict when the food is coming, they seem to register what they were doing at the time the food arrived and repeat the action to make the food come next time. which is a very human thing. It's like humans blowing on dice before a game of craps. So they will walk in anti-clockwise circles because maybe twice they were walking anti-clockwise and the food arrived. And they make the leap that that must be why the food comes.
That's not superstitious, that's just hopeful.
It's superstition, it's kind of doing it. It's like, last time I won this game, I was wearing one red sock, one blue sock. So I'm going to wear a red sock and a blue sock again. And sportsmen do it all the time.
So just repeat actions that happen before...
People do this. People do it all the time.
People do it all the time.
Yeah.
It's called magical thinking, where you think you're having an effect on the world.
Exactly.
And you're not.
You're not.
I can't watch this match because the last round I didn't watch and we won.
Yeah. That's right. Or I was standing up. I was standing up when England scored a goal, so I got to stand up for the rest of the match.
I'm going to go to the toilet now. We'll definitely score.
Yeah, all that. We do it all the time.
My uncle, when he lights a cigar, we always score.
Yes, it happens always.
They're all dead now because I killed them.
It's like a form of megalomania, isn't it? It is. In a bizarre sort of way.
That we can possibly affect the outcome.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that's the nature of superstition. It's quite hard, I'm afraid it has to be said, to find any definition of superstition that doesn't also cover religion. I mean, it makes the same promises, the same suggestions of individual actions.
It's quite fun to feel... You convince yourself that you're involved in the world somehow, then. If I wear my lucky scarf,
yeah,
then I'm really in the game.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're just wearing a scarf.
Yes, that's right. It is. And, of course, for each religion will regard other religions as superstition and theirs as not being. I am religious, you are superstition. In the Catholic Church, it is a sin to be superstitious.
You'll change that when you're Pope.
I will change that when I'm Pope. Think of your own. Oh, stop. There will be some people.
What are we going to do with the gold?
And as Pope Stephen walks out onto the balcony, underneath a ladder with a grenade, with several black cats.
The fact is, American psychologist B.F. Skinner managed to train pigeons to be superstitious by giving them arbitrary food rewards and keeping his fingers crossed, and best of luck to him. Now, what's hysterical about wandering womb trouble? Wandering womb.
Hysterical as in... That's Janet Leigh in Psycho.
It certainly is.
She didn't have a wandering womb. She was being stabbed to death by a maniac.
She was.
She was hysterical for a very good reason.
Yes. But what does hysterical mean? Where does the word come from?
Feeling sleepy.
I think this is something to do with, like, hysterectomy. Yeah. Originally...
The Greek word for uterus is...
Yeah.
..is hystera. So the word hysteria...
Yes, it was Hippocrates also that thought that there was a correlation between mental imbalance and the womb becoming wandering around the body.
He thought the womb literally, like an animal, moved around the female body.
I know, because I've got a very good friend who's a gynaecologist who was telling me.
But that is how the word hysteria came about. It was associated entirely with women from, as you say, the same root as hysterectomy.
She's hysterical, slap her.
Yeah, slap her. That was the attitude that men had towards women's illnesses, or particularly neuroses, that somehow it was to do with their being women, and women of a certain age were associated with all kinds of what were called hysterias, hysterical responses. But it was Freud who said that almost for every real condition you might have, you could have a hysterical version, which was created by the mind, but it was as real, it wasn't feigned, that's the point.
And this was before hysterical became a synonym for hilarious.
Yes.
So if you have a hysterical condition, well, it doesn't feel very hysterical to me.
But,
yes.
But there is such a thing as hysterical blindness and muteness. People will lose the ability to see, although physically there is nothing wrong with their eyes at all, in fact. So, what about Hitler?
Yes. What about Hitler?
You leave Hitler alone, week after week, having a go at Hitler.
Do we know about Hitler and blindness? I mean, he's not blind there, obviously. But do you know any stories about his blindness?
No, I thought he was colourblind. But
no, in the First World War, after a gas attack, he went blind and dumb for some time.
God, that was close, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, it was in...
Someone else would have taken his place.
It was in hospital during that course that he had the vision that he would lead Germany to greatness, unfortunately. Oh. But what's quite interesting...
That went very well, didn't it? That vision. Yeah. Don't listen to visions when you've just had a gas attack.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be terrible if that was actually an evil Labrador like Oscar and it just said, "You will rule the world."
And he's a hypno Hypnodog.
Hypnodog, yeah. There was an American psychiatrist called Walter Langer who wrote a report on Hitler during the war, which is quite interesting. He said both that he thought it was hysterical blindness and speechlessness. There were definitely that. But he also predicted, this is a Freudian analysis, that in Hitler's symbolic vision, as it were, Austria is his father in 1914, old, exhausted, dying, while Germany is his symbolic mother, young, vigorous, married to Austria and about to be violated. And whatever you make of this, it is undoubtedly the case that, unlike almost all Germans, Hitler called Germany Mutterland, not Vaterland. He called it Motherland, not Fatherland. And this Langer went on to say that the most likely outcome of Hitler's life was that Hitler will commit suicide. Probably, he said, in a symbolic womb, which is quite impressive piece of prophecy in a way. So maybe there is something to this Freudian lark after all. Anyway, there you are. Hysteria, as Ronnie rightly knew, used to be attributed to the womb roaming about the body, interfering with other organs. Doctors thought it would cause anything from a nervous breakdown to blindness. And now a question which will test your reflexes. What's the film here of the setting sun? All I want you to do is hit your buzzer at the moment the sun has dropped below the horizon. Speed it up, obviously.
My leads are hay.
It was you got there first, sir. Well too late. Well too late. That is the moment at which the sun is below the horizon. What we see is a mirage. I know it sounds crazy, but it's true. You're looking at me and you're saying, Stephen...
Well, is this to do with how far away it is and you're seeing...
It's to do with the bending of light and the eye not accepting it, essentially. But it is genuinely below the horizon. Physically, in other words, the Earth has turned such that it is not there. I know you're looking very cross and upset and angry. That can't be true about it.
But that's a film of it, though.
I know, but you can get film of mirages and there is nothing there. On the roadside, water puddles.
You can get film of rainbows, yes.
Yeah, that's a photograph. But it's not there. There's no water there. There's no shimmering. It's just air. Now, I'll try and explain it to you. Light from the setting sun passes through our atmosphere at a shallow angle. It's gradually bent as the air density, I mean, the pressure, increases. Not dissimilar to the image of your legs when you sit in a swimming pool. The effect is to artificially raise the sun in the last few minutes of its decline. And by coincidence, the amount of bending is pretty much equal to the diameter of the sun. So it's exactly as it's, you know, there that it's actually disappeared.
I hate this show.
Oh, be interested and please.
Is there?
I know. You're like,
no.
It's the sun.
Not there. Mirage.
Have you ever seen a mirage?
Yes.
Where?
Well, in travelling through the desert in America, you see them all the time. I mean, you see the standard ones in the roads of seeing what appear to be huge puddles of shimmering lakes of water, which are not there. You must have seen those in the roads.
Yeah, but I grew up in Scotland. And they are there.
Okay. Fair enough. Yeah.
In New Zealand, you get sunstrike, quite bad sunstrike off the roads, causes accidents.
And what does that entail? Exactly?
Well, it's the sun. Because New Zealand is so low on the planet, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
And the sun comes through quite a lot of atmosphere to get to it. And the angle of it, when it hits the road, causes a lot of blindness in the eyes of drivers.
Right.
I dare say that the drivers in New Zealand, as they see the sun setting, are reassured to know that it's not there.
Yes, the fact is, despite Phil's reluctance to understand it, the setting sun is actually below the horizon at the moment that its lower edge seems to touch the sea. And so to the place where everything you think you know proves to be an illusion, the nightmare that we call general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, if you'd be so good. What shape is this staircase?
My leads are heavy.
Yes, Phil.
It's not there.
Now, Phil...
Very sleepy.
Spiral.
Oh!
Heads are heavy.
Yeah. Is it a helix?
Yes, it's helical. Well done, exactly right. I know it's terribly pedantic, but the fact is that a spiral is when it gets bigger and bigger and wider and wider and wider, and a helix, it stays the same as a staircase does.
I knew that! I know!
But you just wanted the forfeit, didn't you? Yeah. There you are. So, what's that?
A double helix.
A double helix, exactly. And that is...
That is... What is that? Tell me what animal that is, Stephen.
I can't tell you by looking at it, I'm afraid.
That is a hypno-labrador.
Hypno-labrador's DNA. We've got a lot of it in our bodies. If it was all stretched out, how far would it reach?
Is it something mega, like to the moon and back?
It's so much more mega. A tenth of a light year outside the solar system. That's how long, how much of it is. 50 trillion cells, 23 chromosomes per cell, 220 million base pairs per chromosome.
That really does kick that if you get your skin out, it's half a tennis court in the knackers, doesn't it, that one? Half a light year.
Yeah.
A tennis court.
So, do you know about the Argentine bluebill or lake duck? It has a part of its body that is corkscrew-shaped.
Go on, is it going to be its neck?
It's not going to be its neck.
Ooh. Legs?
Nor its legs. It's its penis, yes. Yes, there are quite a few animals that have spiraled
penises. When they procreate, does it kind of spin in like a screw?
Well...
And if push comes to shove and you're in Argentina with a bottle of Merlot... It's a win double because you get your wine out and you get a pleasured duck.
I'd only say
you don't want it. You don't want it pleasuring in your wine, do you?
Well, this is corked.
Yes. And you'd ask the wine waiter to bring you the bill. But, not only does it have a corkscrew, it has the longest penis relative to its body size of any vertebrate. It's the length of its whole body.
Do you know that, or did the duck tell you?
What about the... you should say mine, well, it's as long as I am. What about the earwig? Hasn't the earwig got a penis?
But the earwig doesn't have a brush at the end of its penis like that animal does.
A brush?
It has a brush.
But a cat,
wow, you can clean up after.
Why do you think?
Like a Dyson.
What do you think? What do you think the brush is for?
Get behind the curtains.
No. What do you think the brush is for on the lake duck's penis? What is the one aim of the male of the species?
It's for brushing the feathers out the way of the lady duck's doodah.
No. What is the purpose of males?
Sorry, the lady duck's
releasing
nani.
Releasing spermatosa into
but releasing yours.
Oh, right.
Not anybody else's. That's why you fight males fight with other males. Though the brush is to remove any sperm from a previous drake that may have been there.
No, stop it.
So you clean out. All right. You clean out the previous sperm, so it's yours. And the weird thing, even weirder, is that the lady duck, her vagina...
The lady duck.
Her vagina is corkscrewed, but it's corkscrewed in the opposite way.
Oh, what a nightmare!
So, oh, you get cross-threaded.
Can't believe it, left hand Fred at this time of the night.
It is quite astonishing, isn't it? It really is.
I feel bad about talking about
you know what? And you know the other thing, Stephen? Male duck's imperial, lady duck's metric. Nightmare.
So true. Ridiculous. There you are, nature. Wonderful nature. So, strictly speaking, a spiral staircase is actually helical. So, why are there so many lavatories in the Pentagon?
One each.
One each. Do you know how many people work in the Pentagon?
Thousands.
23,000.
Whoa!
There aren't 23,000 lavatories, so... No, I'm afraid it's a really ghastly reason. Where is it?
Virginia.
Virginia. Virginia. Virginia was a southern state, and it had laws. And segregation. It was a law that you had to have one lavatory for white people and one for black people. So they were double the number. I'm afraid it's true. It's a horrible truth. It shouldn't have happened because it was built in the 40s under the presidency of FDR, who had specifically outlawed racial segregation in federal, because he couldn't legislate for the states, but he could at least say that no federal building. And so when he arrived for his first inspection, was told he was furious that there were all these lavatories.
Well, it's not very PC, that's true, but have you ever been for a queue in the ladies' loo?
So it's nice for you that there are so many...
Yes, in a way.
You racist.
No. They didn't actually go through with it. I mean, although they built them all for that reason, they were banned from using it and they were never racially...
And look at all the tennis courts they've got as well.
Well, it's vast. That centre bit alone, just to give you a sense of the scale, is 5 acres. Just the middle bit. 17.5 miles of corridor and these 284 lavatories. 6 separate zip codes. Just the Pentagon. But apparently it takes only 7 minutes to walk from one place to another.
Only one cleaner they have.
Yes, poor darling. Racial segregation in Britain, did it ever happen in the Second World War?
I assume yes, judging by that.
For one reason and one reason only.
Because of the Americans.
Because of the Americans. And in fact, it is at least something we can be perhaps vaguely proud of, is that the Americans in the bases who would use pubs insisted that they have pubs for whites and blacks only, and the British publicans said, well, no, we're not going to do that. And the white Americans would come in and see black people there and start fights, and the British would fight with the blacks against we just thought it was intolerable.
Do you know there's propaganda films that they showed American GIs who were going to be stationed over here before they came? Mm. Where you know, sort of with a little old lady coming into a railway carriage, and there's a black GI and a white GI, and she says, "Oh, you must come out for some tea, both of you." And the voiceover is, you know, this would never happen in our country, but you will have to be prepared. And they were preparing the British, GIs that the British
would invite black people.
Yes,
preparing them for the horrors of tea.
It's all rather eye-watering to think that in our parents' lifetime such a thing might have happened.
You may be offered buns.
Yeah.
These are safe to eat.
Anyway, there we are. They built twice as many restrooms as they needed in the Pentagon so they could keep them racially segregated. Name something invented by Vyacheslav Molotov.
Very sleepy.
A Molotov cocktail?
He didn't invent the Molotov cocktail.
He invented the slow, comfortable screw against the wall.
Which is drinking there.
Yeah, it's having one right now.
Yeah.
Piña colada.
Well, he invented some grim things like death lists. There's a Molotov line, rather like a Maginot line, a defensive line, various other things.
He was a Bolshevik.
He was a Bolshevik. Yeah. He was the foreign minister under Stalin and under all the way. He lived till 1986.
Very exciting job.
It certainly was.
Foreign minister under Stalin.
Can't imagine. Oh. Absolutely.
Every day. What are we going to do today? I don't know. He hasn't woken up yet.
The fact is, he claimed his country in the war against Finland was dropping food parcels when, in fact, it was dropping cluster bombs. So the Finns called them Molotov's bread baskets, these bombs that came down. And when they fought against the Soviet tanks, don't forget, the Finns beat the Russians. It was quite an amazing war. They used petrol bombs, and they said, you know, these are Molotov cocktails to go with the bread you're giving us. So it was a kind of their joke. But they humiliated Russia, Finland. It was an extraordinary achievement, really.
Very, very well done.
Yeah, very well done, Finland, absolutely. Which brings me to the real matter of the scores, and my goodness, are they interesting or not? Well, they are quite interesting. I'm afraid in fourth place, with minus 32, it's Robert Webb! Third place with minus 17, Ronnie Ancona. In second place, Alan Davies with minus 8. Which means our runaway winner, our solar skeptic, with minus 2, Phil Jupiters. It's all from QI, so it's good night from Ronnie, Robert, Phil, Alan and me, and I will leave you with this thought. You will tune in again next week. You will. Good night.
Another chance to see tonight's trip to the Arctic with Bruce Parry here on BBC HD at 1:15. But first, we're off to Pompeii.